For having me here. I want to start with a quick story. I promise you it's true. I was in a city in the United States. I don't want to say what city. All right, it was Philadelphia. And I was doing a talk, this is about 8 years ago, in an anarchist bookstore in Philly about a book I'd written called What's My Name, Fools, Sports and Resistance in the United States. And the cover of the book is a big Muhammad Ali face. Just like Ali, like mouth wide open. And I walk in the store and I say, "Hi, I'm Dave Zirin. I'm here to do this talk about What's My Name, Fool." And the very young man, behind the counter looked at me and he said, but you're white." And I said, "Well, yeah, last I checked, I'm white." And he said, "But isn't that you on the cover of the book? You're the What's My Name, Fool guy." And I had to say, "No, I'm not him, that's Muhammad Ali." And I'll never forget looking around the store and seeing that they were selling these big, beautiful posters of people like Malcolm X and Emma Goldman and Joe Hill, like the history of radicalism in the United States, all for $14.99. And I'll never forget thinking to myself, my goodness, here I am in this store that is supposed to celebrate radicalism and resistance, and there's not even a facial recognition of the person who I think is without question the most famous draft resistor, the most famous war resistor in the history of war. As long as there's been war, the most famous resistor is, I think, inarguably Muhammad Ali. And this person did not know this, did not know what he looked like, did not know anything about it. And that, in the United States, certainly is so much about how, says a lot about how the left, particularly the radical left, has historically viewed sports. I mean, they look at it like the way a vegetarian looks at a Big Mac, like this thing that is, should be rejected and shunned, as if there's somehow this direct line between the Super Bowl and Dick Cheney's torture regime. Like it's this, it's all one uninterrupted continuum, the values of sports and the values of authoritarianism, militarism, and death. Racism, sexism, homophobia, sports is a funnel of that. That is a very common view on the radical left. And I have to tell you, that view does not come out of nowhere. And it would be ridiculous of me to just be like, pish posh, they're so silly, they don't understand the whole radical history of sports. Because there's so much in sports that is ugly and disgusting that makes perfect sense why people who want to change the world see sports, particularly organized sports, particularly professional sports, as an obstacle to changing the world. Just a quick story, I'll never forget when I went to a Washington Nationals baseball game about a decade ago. And I had no idea that I had also bought a ticket for something that was called Military Appreciation Night, or MAN was the acronym. And as I'm sitting there watching, just with my jaw on the floor at MAN, they were swearing in a whole group of Marines at home plate while George W. Bush, who was president at the time, and Condoleezza Rice were looking down from the rafters as if they were the emperor and empress of ancient Rome cheering on the Marines. And as I'm watching all this thinking, my goodness, I thought I was going to a baseball game and I actually bought a ticket to a military spectacle. Over the loudspeaker, it said, for people in the stands interested in a career in the military, please visit the appropriate kiosk located at the exit. And so it's like, okay, this is how they're packaging sports. This is how they're packaging a baseball game as a recipe for war. Another story is I was in Brazil during the World Cup and I was at a bunch of the demonstrations that were taking place against the debt displacement and militarization of public space that was happening in Brazil. And there was a demonstration before the first game of the World Cup at legendary Maracanã Stadium in Rio. And Maracanã is an incredibly powerful symbolic space in Rio de Janeiro. If you've never heard of this place, it used to seat between 150 and 200,000 people could be packed into Maracanã, this incredible explosion of public space that would take place there. And over the years, it's been changed and commodified and sanitized to the point of which now it seats only 75,000 people. And the upper deck, which used to be open seating or open standing, where people would watch the games, is now luxury boxes and jumbotrons. And to put insult on top of injury, by the dictates of the Brazilian government and FIFA, they designated that something like a kilometer and a half radius around the stadium, you couldn't even walk on the public streets unless you had a ticket. So people were going to march on the whole area that was cordoned off, saying, you know, whose streets are streets. They said it in Portuguese, of course. And that's where they were marching. And we ran down, my photographer and me, to the edge where the police cordon started so we could actually see when people marched on it and what happened and bear witness to it. And it was the craziest thing because these huge tractor trailer trucks rolled up, and out of the trucks came all of these like very scary military police wearing gas masks, and they were on horses, and their horses had gas masks on. Now, if you've never seen a horse with a gas mask, it is like twice as scary as those horses in Lord of the Rings. I mean, these are like terrifying horses. And there was a packed outdoor bar. Argentina was playing that night. And there was a packed outdoor bar of Argentina fans. And they were drinking and they were watching the spectacle of the police setting up and taking out their like these tear gas bazookas. And they turned it into a soccer chant. And the Argentinians, they started clapping and going, "Oye, oye, 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 policia." You know, using a soccer chant to cheer the military might of cracking down on the protesters. And so the police, this I have all this on film, by the way, so takes out this tear gas bazooka, and they fire it, and it malfunctions and falls about 10 feet in front of them, and there's a huge wind, and all the gas blows back on the Argentinians. And then they start scurrying and kicking over tables and going crazy, and like, because they're being gassed. And it was just so, first of all, that was just a funny ending, at least, believe me, other than the gas, I thought it was very funny. I was laughing till I was crying and crying because of the gas. But it was a pretty amazing thing to see the way, like, the love of soccer and the love of police might just merged very seamlessly together. But given all that's disgusting in the world of sports, I think it's just so myopic to ignore the fact that there's this other people's history tradition that exists in the world of sports, particularly, I mean, my expertise is in the United States. And when you talk about history in the United States, it's impossible to speak about the civil rights movement without talking about Jackie Robinson, the African-American baseball player who broke the color line. It's impossible to speak about the 1960s without talking about Muhammad Ali. It's impossible to speak about the women's movement without speaking about Billie Jean King, the legendary tennis player. It's impossible to talk about the LGBT movement without speaking of Martina Navratilova and more recently Jason Collins and Michael Sam, who play professional sports as openly gay men. And this is just a part of our history, yet, and I think this connects greatly with the centenary discussion. One of the things about this history, though, is that it becomes very commodified and sanctified, which is another reason why I understand why people on the left reject it, because it's presented as if it's a Hallmark special, like this narrative about race in particular in the United States that goes something like this. It goes like segregation, integration, celebration. Like this continuum of progress which Jackie Robinson represents. And it doesn't look at the very real actors and the very real struggles and the very real sacrifices and the very real role of radicals to bring this change to light, really using sports as a sounding reality. Just one example of this is that people know about Jackie Robinson, but they don't know about a man named Lester Red Rodney, who was the sports editor of the Communist Party's newspaper, The Daily Worker, in the 1930s. And that's the first thing people are sort of surprised by. They say, well, the Communist Party had a sports section, and it's, yes, they did. And it was run by a gentleman named Lester Rodney, and he would use the sports page as a way to organize demonstrations against the color line in Major League Baseball. Like activist campaigns, petitioning drives, all kinds of things. And I was able to interview Lester a great deal before he died. He died in 2010 at the age of 96. So he was the sports editor in the 30s, and then he lived to be 96. He was sharp as a tack. And I'll never forget speaking to him. And he stopped at one point after telling me all these stories. And he said, why are you even interested in any of this stuff? And I said, well, because I think it relates to how the left needs to relate to sports today. I thought you actually laid out a blueprint that's been forgotten about real engagement with sports and the aspirations of sports and a way in which we can use it to fight racism, sexism, homophobia, corporatism. And he was like, wow, you really think what I did says all that? And I said, yes, and I want to go around and tell people about it. And Lester said, ah, to be 80 again. Which was very, very cute. But you don't get the Lester Rodney story when you get the Jackie Robinson story. Similarly for Muhammad Ali, of course, and I'm going to talk about this a little more tonight, but, you know, we get the Ali who says, like, you know, I hospitalized a rock, I beat up a brick, I'm so bad, I make medicine sick, and all of that. But you don't get the Muhammad Ali who was a absolutely virtuoso at standing up to U.S. imperialism, at standing with the people of Vietnam, and of doing things like saying, like, imagine an athlete saying this today, saying, damn the money, damn the white man's money, damn the money if it affects my principles. I'll go to jail, so what? We've been in jail for 300 years. And using this hyper-exalted, brought to you by Nike platform to say it. And I think knowing this history, the actuality of this history, is part of the answer to the question about how do you engage with people about sports, how to use sports as a way to engage with a broader audience. Because I think, like with my own work, nothing makes me happier when I get an email from someone who tells me a story about, like, hey, I finally was able to talk to my father about why I hate war. And I was able to do it by using your book and talking about Muhammad Ali. Because usually if I say something like, yeah, the U.S. is an imperial country, his eyes just, you know, glaze over and he doesn't want to talk about it. But I can talk about Muhammad Ali and we can have that discussion through Muhammad Ali. And that's really important because I really do believe that sports is like this ideological Trojan horse that allows us to have very radical discussions with people who otherwise are profoundly alienated from politics. And I think one of the things that we have to understand, like broader framework, it's like, okay, so sports is this powerful, incredible bullhorn to speak about radical politics. How can sports be more political? And that's a question you get, like, why aren't athletes more political? It's not something we're hearing right now in the States, but in years past, that was always the question. Why aren't athletes more political? And I think part of answering that question is you have to say, well, why aren't people more political? And why do we ask of athletes what we do not ask of ourselves? And that's such an important crux to this, is that what happens outside the arena is what determines what happens inside the arena. And then what happens inside the arena can then reflect on what's happening outside the arena. And there can be this incredible relationship between the two. Like, for example, Muhammad Ali did not come down from Planet Awesome to speak out against the Vietnam War. Muhammad Ali in 1960 was Cassius Clay, and if you had asked him who his hero was in 1960, he would have said a professional wrestler named Gorgeous George Wagner. That was his hero in 1960. By 1962, it was Malcolm X. I mean, it happened that quickly. And then by 1968, he was telling people that they should join the Black Panther Party. So the 60s happened to Muhammad Ali and changed him irrevocably. And then Muhammad Ali changed the 60s. So you see this incredibly dynamic relationship work back and forth. And we're seeing that play out today in dramatic fashion. What's so great about December 20th, 2014, is that this is not a historical discussion. This is not an abstract discussion. We're seeing this play out in real time in the United States with the Black Lives Matter movement that, of course, has exploded after a grand jury refused to bring charges following the police shooting death of Michael Brown and then following the choking to death of Eric Garner in Staten Island, other cases, Tamir Rice, 12-year-old killed in Cleveland. All of these cases are having a huge resonance in U.S. society, to the point of which, I mean, I've never seen a mass explosion of demonstrations like this in my lifetime. I mean, we're talking about middle schools walking out in the middle of class and sitting in the middle of roads in the United States. Like, so many demonstrations, you cannot even hope to begin to keep up with what's happening in the U.S. right now. All around this idea that Black Lives Matter and that police violence has to end. And like any movements, these movements are educating people to the point of which things that were only discussed, frankly, in sociological circles or in very left-wing academic circles or activist circles are now common knowledge that people talk about all the time in the United States. Like, did you know that once every 28 hours a police officer kills a Black person in the United States? Something people just, did you know that if you are born a Black man in the United States, you are 21 times more likely to be killed by a police officer than if you're white or even brown in the United States, but that Blackness has been criminalized to such a degree in the U.S. that it's something and there's no justice for it at the same time. And these things are now just part of conversation, and sports has played a major role in making that part of the conversation in a much broader and more profound way than anything that we've seen. And with my remaining time, and I have no idea how much time I have left, but I don't want to abuse the...
10 minutes.
Okay, I'm good. Okay, I don't want to talk too much, but because there are so many incredible people up here, I'd rather hear them than hear myself, so that's a little selfish. I want to sit down soon. But I do want to say that, like, if you chart the way in which the Black Lives Matter movement entered the world of sports, I think it gives a demonstration that's even clearer than any example we can give from the 1960s or the 1970s. Because it started in the world of sports, not with LeBron James, not with Derrick Rose, not with anybody wearing an I Can't Breathe shirt. It actually started early in November when a whole group of activists in Ferguson bought 30 tickets to a St. Louis Rams Monday night football game. And I know the person who bought the tickets. He's not a wealthy person, but he put it all on his credit card and bust in a whole group of the activists in to sit in the stands of the St. Louis Rams San Francisco 49ers game. And they unveiled this huge banner in the upper deck. And the statement of it, I think it just says so much about why Black athletes in particular are protesting right now. Their banner said, "Black Lives Matter on and off the field." And that connected with a lot of athletes in a very strong way. And what also made it connect was the fact that ESPN, which was broadcasting the game, chose not to show the banner. So then the sporting, and this is like the power of social media, which needs to be underlined over and over again for why this movement among athletes has taken off. Because other sports bodies, like big broadcast sports bodies that were at that game, not only noted what happened, but noted that ESPN chose not to show it. So then you have a double story, the fact that it was shown and the fact that ESPN chose not to show it. And then this whole discussion then happens on social media, and ESPN actually has to issue a formal response for why they chose not to show this, which garnered all this attention in the stadium itself. So that's how it started. And then what you started to see was more and more of these demonstrations, like in Portland, in Washington, D.C., in Brooklyn, to use three examples. People marched on basketball stadiums while there were games going on, doing civil disobedience in front to keep fans from getting in. Now, some of those fans were very annoyed, not surprising, but it also led to a lot of visibility and engagement and to athletes starting to be asked about what was going on. And that's really when the crux of this thing started to turn, because it started with a woman named Ariana Smith, and I can't say that name often enough, Ariana Smith. She is a Division III basketball player at a very small school. I don't know if you guys know what that means by Division III, but let's just say there are probably more people here today than might go to a typical Division III basketball game. And she was playing a game on Saturday, November 29th in Clayton, Missouri, just a few minutes away from Ferguson. And she felt like she had to do something. It just felt obscene to her to just play so close to Ferguson while the National Guard was in the streets gassing people. So what she chose to do, what she was really smart about it too, once again, the power of social media, she brought a friend of hers to the game to film what she was about to do, and she then uploaded it to YouTube immediately. And what she did was, during the national anthem, she put her hands up in the now iconic hands up, don't shoot motion. She drops to her knees and then fell right on the ground. And she stayed on the ground and did not move for 4.5 minutes, which was a symbolic gesture towards the 4.5 hours that Michael Brown lay in the streets in Ferguson before anybody came and did anything about it. Michael Brown's body just lay in the street for 4.5 hours. So she lay there for 4.5 minutes. And eventually she walked right off the court and she raised her fist in the air as she was leaving. And that event started something. By the way, she was suspended from the team. She was then reinstated on the team after being kicked out of practice. Campus security was called the next day when she tried to go there. So she paid a real price for it. And I want you to keep that in mind, the price she paid at little Division III Knox College, like the incredible backlash that she received. So that's the 29th. November 30th, that's when the St. Louis Rams players come out and raise their hands like this and have things written on their bodies like my kids' lives matter. You know, connecting direct, and they said things that were direct references to the signs that people held up in the stands, saying, like, I want the fans to know that I'm not just an athlete, I'm not just, you know, you can't just see me as a human being when I'm running up and down the field. I have kids who are at risk because of the police in this country, and I'm not gonna be silent about it. So the next day, and that story might not have gone so big, but the next day, the St. Louis Police Union put out this insanely ham-handed statement about how they were going to wage a full-scale campaign against the National Football League and exercise their freedom of speech to cripple the NFL, which is hilarious because if you know anything about the First Amendment in the United States, First Amendment's an interesting thing. The First Amendment does not prevent your employer from firing you. You know, that's, so a lot of people think First Amendment means you could say it. That's not true. The First Amendment doesn't prevent your neighbor from telling you to shut the hell up, but the First Amendment does allow you to speak without interference from a governmental body. So a police union saying, we're gonna shut you up, was an obvious and gross, and absolutely, I mean, as ham-handed as the same cops who were wearing t-shirts that said, I am Darren Wilson, after the police officer who killed Michael Brown. It was that ham-handed. And people saw that, and people, once again, had to start choosing sides. Do I stand with this incredibly gross St. Louis Police Union, or do I stand with the players? And then, just days after that, you have Eric Garner and the grand jury not indicting the police officer who choked him to death on video. By the way, the person who filmed Eric Garner being choked to death was indicted for filming it, but the police officer who choked him to death was not indicted. And then that led to a new round of protests, Derrick Rose being the first of the Chicago Bulls. After Derrick Rose does it, LeBron James, the biggest basketball star, maybe the biggest sports star in the country, puts out on Twitter that he really liked that shirt and says, maybe I should wear one too. Because he puts that on Twitter, a former teammate of his, Jarrett Jack, runs to his union and says, said to both of them, I want to get some t-shirts made. I'm going to go to LeBron and give it to him. And that's how that happened. Like through social media, actually the athletes then communicate with each other, and then LeBron wore the shirt, as did many of his teammates the next night. And now it's becoming this regular occurrence of players wearing these shirts, including the entire women's teams at Notre Dame and Berkeley. Berkeley took it another step, wearing shirts that had the names of people historically and present day who've been killed either by police or by lynching. So you have these women on the court, 19 years old, with Emmett Till across their body as they're going out to practice. I mean, this is insanely powerful, which of course then leads to Emmett Till becoming this thing that people are Google searching, like, well, who was Emmett Till? Was he killed by police? No, he wasn't, but why is his name relevant? You know, it becomes this whole nother set of discussions that are bursting out into the open. And here's the part of it which I find so interesting and so evocative about this moment. Remember Ariana Smith, I said, remember what happened to her, the backlash, little Division III, Knox College. There have been no punishments for the Notre Dame players, no punishments for the Cal Berkeley players, no punishments for LeBron James, no punishments for the St. Louis Rams. This in and of itself is remarkable. I mean, you think about how authoritarian sports leagues, the NFL stands for the No Fun League, people joke, because they'll fine you if you wear the wrong color shoelaces. That's real. They will fine you for wearing the no ball color shoelaces. People might know the name Pat Tillman, the football player turned Army Ranger who died in Afghanistan. His best friend wore a little patch with his number on it once after he died, and his best friend was fined $20,000 by the NFL for commemorating his dead friend. And yet here's the NFL, they're not going to fine anybody for doing this. And that to me mirrors something that's happening in the streets, because I've been to a lot of these demonstrations. And with the exception, and I've been following it, with the exceptions of I would say, Ferguson and Berkeley is always its own story, to be very clear, it's remarkable how hands-off the police are when we're doing things like sitting in the streets, disrupting traffic. There's clearly been some sort of national strategy being called, saying we don't want big arrests, brutality, all the rest of it. I mean, so much so that it's almost ridiculous to see how few police there are at a lot of these demonstrations where we're disrupting traffic and doing all these things. And that in and of itself, I think, says something about how on defense the police are right now, ideologically, and how on defense people who support the police are right now. And just my last point, though, about why it's so important when these athletes do speak out, and I gotta say, like, I'm so charged by this interplay right now between the protests and the athletes that it's really hard for me to even speak or summon examples of people doing it wrong in terms of how to engage with, because right now I think the only way to engage with sports politically incorrectly is to not engage at all, because it's just too open to do right now. It's just, I mean, the avenues are so wide open and it's so inspiring. But the number one thing it does is that when athletes speak out, in the United States, it punctures privilege. Yes, it inspires activists, and that's wonderful. Yes, it raises visibility, and that's wonderful. Yes, it makes people feel like you're part of a real movement. That's wonderful. But the most important thing is that it punctures privilege, because there are masses of people in the United States who are part of the U.S. middle class, who are people who maybe their parent, I'm talking largely about a white middle class in the United States, that maybe previous generations, their parents were in unions, and those unions are now gone. And so these places in the Midwest, for example, that used to be union strongholds, now everybody's an independent contractor. They hate public sector unions. They vote Republican. It's a completely different political calculus than the ones their parents lived through. And these are the folks who would be so likely to turn away from these protests, to ignore these protests, to not care about these protests, to not recognize that to be black in the United States is to live an entirely distinct existence than it is to be white and middle class in the United States. And these are the folks who are having to confront this movement because athletes are speaking out. So they're like, I told a story about my second cousin, Frank, or no, second cousin by marriage, Frank. He's kind of an embarrassing person, the most apolitical person you've ever met in your entire life. I mean, seriously, it's like you ask him a political question and he'll look at you like you're talking about particle physics. Like, huh? It's like, oh, Obama's still president? You know, like really, like does not care about anything. But he listens to sports radio for 4 hours a day as he's driving to and from work. And Frank is sitting there and he's listening to these sports radio dunderheads like debate and discuss, should these athletes be wearing these shirts? And it's forcing him to confront. And he went home and he looked at the Eric Garner video, something he never would have done otherwise. And now Frank's like calling me up and messaging me and saying, did you see this? Did you hear about this? And it's like it's opening his eyes and waking him up in a way that's really powerful. It reminds me of the quote by the great Indian writer Arundhati Roy, who spoke about that there is a war going on, a hidden war, but once you see it, you can't unsee it. And then the act of choosing to not see it becomes as political an act as doing something. Like all these people are seeing things and now they're having to make political choices about what side they're on, when in the past they had the ultimate privilege, which was the privilege of ignorance. And it just reminds me so strongly of one of the famous quotes by one of my heroes, the late radical historian Howard Zinn, who said, you can't be neutral on a moving train. I mean, the train is moving. And neutrality is just not an option in the current climate. And sports is one of the great reasons for that. So thank you very much.